In the early 1960s, Canada was among the early pioneers of space technology and research. Taking advantage of then-cutting-edge technologies like the transistor and solar panels, Canadian scientists produced the Alouette and ISIS series of satellites. They were an immense engineering challenge and represented the high watermark of a tradition of ionospheric research that began back before the establishment of Canada as a nation. Canada's geography drives our interest in ionospheric research. European explorers using magnetic compasses noticed anomalies as they approached the North Pole. Their compasses became unreliable and often gave conflicting readings or drifted while stationary. This complicated exploration, and so scientific research into the Earth's magnetic field was initiated. In 1840, Irish scientist Sir Edward Sabine established the first magnetic observatory in Canada at the University of Toronto. It was one of five stations built around the world to study and measure the Earth's magnetic field. He was the first to show a direct relationship between it and the numbers and strengths of sunspots. After his work was completed, the station was transferred to the colonial government. They decided to continue the magnetic and meteorological observations, and the site remained in use until the 1950s. Data from the Toronto Observatory was also used to demonstrate a connection between the Earth's magnetic field and one of Canada's most iconic phenomena, the aurora borealis. These brilliant displays of color have enchanted all who have seen it, but their cause hadn't yet been determined. The first international polar year in 1882 took measurements of meteorological, magnetic, and auroral phenomena north of the Arctic Circle. These results further confirmed the connection between solar activity, auroral phenomena in northern Canada, and the Earth's magnetic field. In the days before communication satellites, long-range radio communication depended on bouncing signals off the ionosphere. Marconi and his team used this principle with their pioneering transatlantic radio message, sent initially from Signal Hill in St. John's, Newfoundland in 1901, and then more definitively from Glace Bay, Nova Scotia in 1902. Consistent long-range communications were difficult to maintain due to a lack of understanding behind its underlying principles. As beyond line-of-sight radio technology was developed further, scientists around the world wanted to know more about this reflective layer and what factors influence our ability to use it for communication. In 1916, the Government of Canada established the predecessor of the National Research Council of Canada to coordinate scientific research across the country. It oversaw the second International Polar Year, which took place in 1932. Scientists used radio equipment for the first time to show the relationship between solar activity and the ionosphere. Experimentation by the NRCC and the Canadian military throughout the 1930s and during World War II began to map out a rough idea of the various layers in the ionosphere and their densities. Ground-based measurements further confirmed the growing theoretical consensus on its cause and properties of the ionosphere. The NRCC was becoming a world leader in ionospheric research, and its scientists were looking for a new way to probe it directly. That opportunity presented itself with the development of rocketry. Canada was developing a high-powered sounding rocket series called the Black Brant, starting in the mid-1950s. Unfortunately, it hadn't reached operational service before the International Geophysical Year that began in 1958. An American nike-cajun sounding rocket from the Churchill Range in northern Manitoba would launch the first Canadian science payload into a suborbital flight up and into the lower ionosphere. The Black Brant series was developed further, and in 1960 it began carrying scientific payloads of researchers from all over the world. Slowly, the ionosphere was beginning to reveal its secrets, but more study was needed. While the Black Brant sounding rockets were great at probing it from below, scientists now wanted to study it from above as well. 1957 saw the first artificial satellite launch with the Russian Sputnik 1. Sputnik sparked a fierce competition between the world's most developed economies, and Canada would join the competition by developing new hardware, followed by a series of orbital scientific satellites. The first Canadian hardware in space was a cosmic noise detector launched on board the American navigation satellite Transit 2A in June of 1960. This was the first successful exo-atmospheric measurement of cosmic noise above the ionosphere. In 1961, Russian Yuri Gagarin became the first person to orbit the Earth and return safely. This hastened an American response, and the STEM system, or storable tubular extendable mechanism, which was developed by de Havilland Aircraft of Downsview, Ontario, would be crucially involved in the early American manned space program. It was launched on a suborbital flight with Alan Shepard aboard the Freedom 7 capsule in 1961. STEM was launched again in 1962 with John Glenn in the orbital Friendship 7 capsule. It would also be present on most Mercury, Gemini, and Apollo spacecraft, as well as many communication satellites. Canada's opportunity to launch a satellite of its own came back in 1958 when the Americans' newly formed National Aeronautics and Space Agency invited international partners for peaceful space missions. The Canadian government took the invitation and directed the Defense Research Telecommunications Establishment to begin developing the specifications for the new topside sounding satellite. It was decided that it should measure energetic particles, act as an ionosode, and have an operational lifespan of at least 12 months to gather its scientific data. Design work at the DRTE began in early 1959. Program Director Dr. John Chapman, along with Dr. Eldon Warren, Keith Brown, Dr. Colin Franklin, and John Marr, played critical roles in organizing and progressing the project. The early stages of the project had the following stated goals: to bring Canada into the space age by developing new space technologies, to improve long-range communications in higher latitudes, and to study the ionosphere through measurement of electron densities and flux at altitudes between 300 and 1,000 kilometers. To achieve its scientific goals, the Alouette would need to be equipped as a small ionospheric observatory. As such, it would need to carry an ionospheric sounder, a VLF receiver, an energetic particle detector, and a cosmic noise detector. The launcher was to be the thor-agena B. At the time, most space rockets had a fairly low reliability rate. As such, it was decided to make two identical copies to safeguard against launch failure. The 145.7 kilogram Alouette was built around a central cylinder measuring 86 centimeters in length. Its 107 centimeter wide octagonal internal structure included room for electronics and batteries. The satellite was to be powered by photoelectric solar panels which covered the exterior surfaces of the craft. These were a new technology at the time, and so the power supply was made larger with bigger batteries to counteract the expected degradation of the panels. Two dipole antennas measuring 45.7 meters and 22.8 meters from tip to tip were extended after launch and shared by three experiments on board the spacecraft. The antenna were stowed and deployed by four STEM units. Alouette was spin-stabilized to about 1.4 RPM with the antennas extended. Canadian expertise in solid-state electronics allowed the move from vacuum tubes to transistors. This led to a very robust design capable of withstanding degradation and interference. The telemetry system was a more difficult challenge than expected. American contractors declined to produce the telemetry transmitter because they felt that the specifications were too difficult to meet due to the presence of the sounder equipment on board the satellite. RCA Victor, based in Montreal, took up the challenge and produced a working system within 2 months. The system worked flawlessly and was used as a standard design for subsequent Canadian and U.S. ionospheric topside sounding satellites. It was decided to make the transmitter 10 times more powerful than the calculated minimum requirements. This would help ground station receivers and facilitated more high-quality ionograms. No recording devices were included on board, and so data from the satellite was only available when it was within range of a ground-based receiver. To receive the signal, an 18-meter diameter tracking antenna was built at the Shirley Bay Research Center near Ottawa. It now serves as one of the few physical reminders of the Alouette program, and will hopefully be preserved to inspire future generations. With the construction complete, the Alouette was moved to the Canadian Armament and Research Development Laboratory in Valcalce, Quebec, for environmental testing. All the electronic systems, batteries, solar cells, and antenna were tested thoroughly by the team. The STEM units were tested in 1G conditions as well as 0G. It was considered over-designed, but everything was fully tested and operational at launch. Previous deployment issues when testing the STEM systems on sounding rockets was averted by the design work and by conducting these tests. The team also tested the satellite for its spin tolerances by mounting it on a rotating platform. The STEM units were again deployed and showed good control. G-force testing was carried out using a centrifuge. This was to simulate stresses of its launch into orbit. Vibration testing was also carried out for the same purpose. The DRTE team felt good about their little invention and flew the Alouette down to the Goddard Space Flight Center near Washington, D.C. in the United States for evaluation and acceptance by NASA. They tested all the systems in conditions similar to what it would experience in orbit. These tests were successful and echoed the results of the testing by CARD. The Alouette was then flown to the Vandenberg Air Force Base in California, where it waited for its ride to orbit. By 1962, both the satellite and rocket were ready for launch. On September 29, 1962, the thor-agena B sat on its pad ready to receive its payload. The Alouette was carried up and mated to the rocket atop a big spring. This would help it separate from the final stage once it had achieved orbit. With all the systems working and the team standing by, the countdown to Canada's true entrance into the space age began. The thor-agena worked perfectly and Alouette achieved a fairly circular polar orbit at 1,000 kilometers altitude above the surface. The team listened anxiously for its first transmission. The ground station at Shirley Bay received the signal, and Canada officially became the third country in the world to have a satellite in orbit, behind the US and Russia. American scientists had very low confidence in the Canadian satellite, and so no plans were made to receive or use any data from it. After proving itself, the ground station array was expanded along the 80-degree west meridian to include stations in Hawaii, Singapore, Australia, Europe, and Central Africa. Data was being recorded for around 6 hours a day. Although the Americans had initially expected it to work in space for only a few hours, it in fact worked for 10 years before it was shut down by ground controllers. In that time, it collected a mountain of data and led to more than 280 scientific papers and a much deeper understanding of the Earth's ionosphere. It also proved to be a pivotal moment in the history of the Canadian space program. It had established itself as a world leader in the peaceful use of space. One issue with the satellite was noted. Its spin was slowing down. When it was launched, it had a spin of 1.4 RPMs after antenna extension, but after 500 days, it had slowed to 0.6 RPM. It gradually progressed towards the gravitational gradient and ended up with its longer antenna pointing earthward. This complicated the mission immensely, but the project was still able to collect good data with most of its systems misaligned. With the success of the Alouette, further Canadian satellites were planned. The DRTE proposed a program called International Satellites for Ionospheric Studies, or ISIS. It proposed the construction of 4 more topside sounding satellites, 3 Canadian and 1 American. The first in the new series was the backup satellite for the Alouette program. It was refurbished to include an additional probe experiment and an expanded sounder frequency range. It also included plates on the 23-meter antenna to correct the D-spin that occurred with the first Alouette. On November 29, 1965, it was launched as Alouette 2 simultaneously with the American contribution Explorer 31 on a thor-agena B rocket. Its orbit was elliptical, ranging between 500 kilometers and 3,000 kilometers. It flew along the 80-degree west meridian like the Alouette 1, and so was tracked by the same stations, but recording time was expanded to 8 hours per day. It operated until July of 1975, when the mission was terminated. The satellite was then successfully reactivated on November 28th and 29th in order to obtain data on its 10th anniversary like the Alouette 1 managed to do. The next two satellites were of a new design. They were each designed to house 10 experiments to expand upon the Alouette series and help answer new questions about ion mass and electron and ion temperatures. ISIS 1 was heavier and slightly larger than the Alouette. It weighed 241 kilograms and measured 1.27 meters in diameter and 1.04 meters in length. STEM units extended 2 dipole antennas measuring 73 meters and 18.7 meters. It included sweep and fixed frequency ionosodes, a VLF receiver, energetic and soft particle detectors, an ion mass spectrometer, an electrostatic probe, an electrostatic analyzer, a beacon transmitter, and a cosmic noise experiment. Unlike its predecessors, the ISIS series were equipped with tape recorders allowing for 1 hour of data collection. Timers could be set to trigger recordings when it was outside the range of a ground station. The data was then transmitted exclusively to the Shirley Bay Research Center in Ottawa. When the tape recorder was not in use, the satellite functioned as the Alouette did. ISIS-1 was launched successfully on January 30, 1969, by a Delta E-1 rocket into an elliptical 578 by 3,500-kilometer polar orbit. Data was again collected at sites along the 80-degree west meridian. ISIS-2 was almost a copy of ISIS-1. It included a few additional experiments like a red-line photometer and an oral scanning photometer, intended to explore the optical components of the ionosphere. The two Canadian-built optical experiments provided the first-ever pictures of the aurora from above. Perhaps the most progressive addition was the automatic ionogram transmission scheme. This allowed automatic operation of the sounder once every 3 minutes. It was intended to make ionospheric research accessible to smaller institutions. ISIS-2 was launched on March 31, 1971, by another Delta E-1 rocket into a near-circular polar orbit at 1,400 kilometers altitude. Canadian operations of the two satellites continued until March 13, 1984, when the mission was ended and they were both deactivated. The Japanese Radio Research Laboratories requested to reactivate and to continue to use the ISIS-1 and 2 satellites. Canada obliged, and the Japanese reactivated and operated them from late 1984 until early 1990, when they were deactivated for the final time. After the ISIS series in 1971, the government decided to redirect Canada's space program from the science of the ionosphere to long-range communications and remote sensing technology. Canada had established itself as a highly reliable and innovative player in the global space race. The decision to focus on direct commercial applications and integration gave birth to a successful space industry with both domestic and export markets. The Alouette and ISIS series of satellites had directly produced more than 1,200 research papers exploring all aspects of the Earth's ionosphere, the aurora, and other phenomena. They had also demonstrated to the world that Canada was a world leader in the peaceful use of space, a title it continues to hold today.